A 1, 2, 3, 4.
Oh, hello.
Dead. He was shot a short time ago outside his Manhattan apartment building. He died at Roosevelt Hospital. Police have a suspect in custody.
Get out of the limousine. And they went inside the gate, and then all of a sudden they heard 5-6 shots, and that was it.
Four cops pulled John Lennon out and put him into the back of a police car.
John came out, and he looked at me, and I think he recognized, here's the fella that I signed the album earlier. I took 5 steps toward the street, turned, withdrew my Charter Arms 38, and fired 5 shots into his back.
Welcome to the Serious Rock Talk Crime Podcast. What I want to look at today is something that came to me when I was rereading Professor Joseph Campbell's famous book, The Hero with 1,000 Faces. Campbell believes that myths don't really change between cultures and over time because, in a way, people don't really change. There's an inevitability to life, aside from the birth, life, death cycle. Campbell examines the actions of heroes and villains. He demonstrates how much of what we do and what they do is predictable. He discusses the qualities of a hero, which we try to emulate, and the qualities of a villain, which we try to reject. Now, if we take the murder of John Lennon by Mark David Chapman and hold it against the grid presented by Joseph Campbell, a certain clarity slowly appears, which shall develop as we progress. And by progress, I mean pursue the inevitable trajectory of the assailant, Mark David Chapman. As a sidebar, there's a parallel. If you look at the life, the brief life, of Lee Harvey Oswald, that sense of inevitability persists. You end up asking yourself, how could he do anything else in this life besides trying to kill someone who threatened his twisted notions? It's as if the forces of nature, the forces in his brain, conspired in a malevolent way, surging downhill. The same goes for Mark David Chapman. When you learn about how terribly troubled he was, the mental illness he suffered, the senseless death of John Lennon becomes, shall I say, a bit easier to understand. So let's take a look at the sad, dark reasons behind the death of John Lennon. Mark David Chapman was born in 1955 in Fort Worth, Texas. His father was a staff sergeant in the U.S. Air Force, and his mother was a nurse. His younger sister was born 7 years later. As a boy, Chapman stated he lived in fear of his father, who he claimed was physically abusive toward his mother and unloving toward him. Chapman began to fantasize about having godlike power over a group of imaginary little people who lived in the walls of his bedroom. Okay, lots of kids have, shall I say, similar beliefs. So far, so good, kind of. I mean, he's starting to carry some baggage. Chapman moved to Decatur, Georgia at an early age and attended Columbia High School. He later recalled being targeted by bullies due to his lack of athleticism. By the time he was 14, Chapman was using drugs and skipping classes, and at one point ran away from home to live on the streets of Atlanta for 2 weeks. Okay, the long and winding pathway has begun construction, one that eventually leads to New York City in December of 1980. In 1971, Chapman became a born-again Presbyterian and distributed biblical tracts. He met his first girlfriend and began work as a summer camp counselor at the YMCA in DeKalb County, Georgia. He was very popular with the children at the camp, and he was promoted to assistant director after winning an award for outstanding counselor. Those who knew him in the caretaking professions unanimously declared him a wonderful worker. Okay, let's take a sanity pause and see where we are. We have Mark David Chapman, a very well-liked camp counselor. There's really nothing suspicious about him. He appears to be an educated, sensitive soul. So what happened to him? Okay, on the recommendation of a friend, Chapman read J.D. Salinger's novel, The Catcher in the Rye. The novel eventually took on great personal significance for him, and to the extent that he reportedly wished to model his life after its main character, Holden Caulfield. Now, I assume most of you have read Catcher in the Rye, or at least have heard of it. In that book, the protagonist, Holden Caulfield, is one troubled young man. As I recall, he was about 16 years of age in the book. So, to model your life after him, well, we shall see the role of Holden Caulfield in the life of Mark David Chapman. And it's not good. After graduating from high school, Chapman moved for a time to Chicago and played guitar in churches and Christian night spots. He worked successfully for World Vision with Vietnamese refugees at a resettlement camp at Fort Chaffee in Arkansas, after a brief visit to Lebanon for the same work. He was named an area coordinator and key aide to program director David Moore, who later said Chapman cared deeply for children and worked hard. Chapman accompanied Moore to meetings with government officials, and U.S. President Gerald Ford shook his hand. Okay, President Gerald Ford shook the hand of Mark David Chapman, the hand that would hold a gun about 6 years later and take down the former Beatle. You know, folks, sometimes the world is a smaller place than we imagine, isn't it? Chapman attended Covenant College, a Presbyterian liberal arts college in Lookout Mountain, Georgia. However, he fell behind in his studies and became racked with guilt over having a previous affair. He started having suicidal thoughts and began to feel like a failure. He dropped out of Covenant College after just one semester, and his girlfriend broke off the relationship soon after. He returned to work at the resettlement camp, but left after an argument with a supervisor. Okay, this is where we really begin to see trouble. He was mentally ill and needed help, but he didn't get it. In 1977, Chapman relocated to Hawaii, where he attempted suicide by carbon monoxide asphyxiation. He connected a hose to his car's exhaust pipe, but the hose melted and the attempt failed. A psychiatrist admitted Chapman to Castle Memorial Hospital for clinical depression. Upon his release, he began working at the hospital as a janitor. And after Chapman's parents began divorce proceedings, his mother joined him in Hawaii. In 1978, Chapman embarked on a six-week trip around the world. The vacation was partly inspired by the film and novel Around the World in 80 Days. Using his YMCA connections for free or discounted accommodations, he visited Tokyo, Hong Kong, Singapore, Bangkok, New Delhi, Beirut, Geneva, London, Paris, and Dublin. The trip concluded with a brief visit to Atlanta to visit his family. He also began a romantic relationship with his travel agent, whom he married in June of 1979. Chapman got a job at Castle Memorial Hospital as a printer, working alone rather than with staff and patients. He was fired by the hospital and later rehired. Following an argument with a nurse, he finally quit for good. After this, Chapman took a job as a night security guard at a high-end apartment complex and began drinking heavily to cope with his depression. All right, he has bad depression, and he's self-medicating. As his psychological state worsened, Chapman developed a series of obsessions, including The Catcher in the Rye and John Lennon. In September of 1980, he wrote a letter to a friend in which he stated, "I'm going nuts," and he signed the letter, "The Catcher in the Rye." Chapman allegedly started planning to kill Lennon 3 months prior to the murder. A longtime fan of Lennon's former band, The Beatles, Chapman turned against Lennon due to a religious conversion and Lennon's highly publicized 1966 remark about the Beatles being more popular than Jesus. According to a friend, quote, "He was angry that Lennon would preach love and peace, but yet have millions." Chapman later said, "He told us to imagine no possessions, and there he was with millions of dollars and yachts and farms and country estates, laughing to people like me who had believed the lies and bought the records. I would listen to his music and I would get angry at him for saying that he didn't believe in God, that he just believed in him and Yoko, and that he didn't believe in the Beatles. And that angered me. I just wanted to scream out, 'Who does he think he is, saying these things about God and heaven and the Beatles? Saying that he doesn't believe in Jesus and things like that.' At that point, my mind was going through a total blackness of anger and rage. And my mindset was with Golden Caulfield and anti-phoniness." According to Chapman, in a later parole hearing, he had a hit list of other potential targets in mind, including Paul McCartney, Johnny Carson, Elizabeth Taylor, George C. Scott, Jacqueline Kennedy, and Ronald Reagan.
In this letter, Chapman writes, "Lennon was a phony of the highest degree, but there were others who could and would have served the same purpose."
He said that these people on the hit list, including John Lennon, were phonies. They were not taking their money and giving it to the charities that he thought they should be giving to.
It is rumored that Chapman traveled to Woodstock, New York during one of his visits to the state in search of the musician Todd Rundgren, another target of obsession. Chapman was wearing a promotional t-shirt for Rundgren's album Hermit of Meek Hollow when he was arrested and had a copy of Runt, the Ballad of Todd Rundgren, in his Manhattan hotel room. Now here's a poignant story. On the day of the murder, David Bowie was appearing on Broadway in the play The Elephant Man. Quote, "I was second on his list. Chapman had a front row ticket to The Elephant Man the next night. John and Yoko were supposed to sit front row for that show too." So the night after John was killed, there were three empty seats in the front row. "I can't tell you how difficult that was to go on. I almost didn't make it." Well, there's a great title for a related piece, Three Empty Seats. Chapman went to New York City in late October 1980, intending to kill Lennon, but left to obtain ammunition from an unwitting friend in Atlanta before returning in November. While in New York, Chapman was inspired by the film Ordinary People to stop his plans. He returned to Hawaii and told his wife that he had been obsessed with killing Lennon, showing her the gun and bullets, but she did not inform the police or mental health services. Chapman later said that the commandment, "Thou shalt not kill," flashed on the television at him and was on the wall hanging that his wife put up in their apartment. He made an appointment to see a clinical psychologist, but he did not keep it and flew back to New York on December the 6th, 1980. At one point, he considered ending his life by jumping from the Statue of Liberty. On December the 7th, Chapman and his wife talked on the phone about getting help with his problems by first working on his relationship with God. On the morning of December the 8th, he left his room at the Sheraton Hotel, leaving personal items behind that he wanted the police to find. He bought a copy of The Catcher in the Rye, in which he wrote, "This is my statement," signing it Holden Caulfield. He then spent most of the day near the entrance to the Dakota apartment building where Lennon lived, talking to fans and the doorman. Early in the morning, Chapman was distracted and missed seeing Lennon step out of a taxi and enter the Dakota. Later in the morning, he met Lennon's housekeeper, who was returning from a walk with Lennon's 5-year-old son, Sean. Chapman reached in front of the housekeeper to shake Sean's hand and called him a beautiful boy, quoting Lennon's song, Beautiful Boy, Darling Boy. Around 5 p.m., Lennon and his wife, Yoko Ono, were leaving the Dakota for a recording session at the record plant. As they walked toward their limousine, Chapman, without saying a word, held out a copy of Lennon's album, Double Fantasy, for Lennon to sign, which he did. In fact, there's a famous photograph in which you see Lennon signing the album, and in the background is Mark David Chapman. Around 10:50 p.m., Lennon and Ono returned to the Dakota in a limousine.
I was sitting at the inside of the arch of the Dakota building, and it was dark, it was windy. Jose, the doorman, was out along the sidewalk. The limousine pulled up, the door opened. I said, this is it.
They got out of the vehicle, past Chapman, and walked toward the archway entrance of the building. From the street behind them, Chapman fired 5 hollow point bullets from a .38 special revolver, 4 of which hit Lennon in the back and shoulder. Chapman remained at the scene following the shooting, sitting on a curb, and appeared to be reading The Catcher in the Rye when the police officers arrived. They arrested him without incident. Lennon was pronounced dead on arrival. 3 hours later, Chapman told the police, I'm sure the big part of me is Holton Caulfield, who is the main person in the book. The small part of me must be the devil. Chapman was formally charged with second-degree murder. He confessed to police that he had used hollow-point bullets to, quote, ensure Lennon's death.
Good evening. The death of a man who sang and played the guitar overshadows the news from Poland, Iran, and Washington tonight. Former Beatle John Lennon, who was 40, was shot and killed outside his luxury apartment in New York. The alleged killer is an unemployed security guard and printer who had lived in Hawaii. News of Lennon's death touched off a wave of shock and mourning around the world.
Chapman's wife had known of her husband's preparations for killing Lennon, but took no action because Chapman did not follow through at the time. She did not face any charges. More than a dozen psychologists and psychiatrists interviewed Chapman in the 6 months prior to his trial. All 6 defense experts concluded that Chapman was psychotic, 5 diagnosed paranoid schizophrenia, while the 6th felt his symptoms were more consistent with manic depression. The court-appointed experts concurred with the prosecution's examiners that he was delusional yet competent to stand trial. Chapman told a friend he had killed Lennon to promote the reading of The Catcher in the Rye. At his trial, the judge ordered psychiatric treatment and sentenced him to 20 years to life imprisonment. By the way, he has been denied parole 13 times since the year 2000. Okay, let's place this terrible chain of events on a kind of macro psychological graph. I don't know how many of you have read Professor Joseph Campbell's book, The Hero with 1,000 Faces. George Lucas sure did, and based the structure of Star Wars on it. But it's loaded with remarkable insights. Campbell believes all hero stories can be distilled into one single hero story. All great heroes, in real life and fiction, pass through a series of stages. The hero lives in an ordinary world at first that is safe and familiar. Something happens to him, an inciting incident, and he's put into a more dangerous world. In this second world, the hero takes on a mission, a quest of some kind. He's wounded in some way, and he has a missing quality. It might be humility, confidence, courage, empathy, whatever it is. The hero encounters villains and setbacks. He undergoes suffering. He gets guidance from wise entities. And he's tested to his limit. In a way, he masters both worlds, the safe world that he knew and the scary world that he's in. And he's transformed into a better person. And he returns home and he shares what he's learned. Cue the closing credit. Now, villains, it turns out, undergo several of these same stages. They too must leave the comforts of their world. And there are basic commonalities between heroes and villains. They're trying to accomplish something. Mark David Chapman felt like he was ridding the world of pretension, of people lying and posturing, phonies, in Holden Caulfield's lexicon. And the biggest phony, or one of the biggest, had to be John Lennon. Plus, Lennon had rejected organized religion. Both heroes and villains encounter adversity in life and experience suffering. Mark David Chapman certainly did. Both heroes and villains at the end of their journey leave a lasting imprint on society. Yes, you could say that. Now, there are striking differences between a hero and a villain. Whereas heroes become aware that they are wounded or they're lacking some quality, villains don't. And Mark David Chapman, he recognized his mental illness perhaps, but he did nothing about it but self-medicate. Heroes are influenced by wise mentors, and villains are swayed by immoral mentors. Now, Holden Caulfield of Catcher in the Rye is hardly a dark and immoral mentor. Rather, it's Chapman's interpretation of that book that fulfills the rule. Whereas heroes resist the hero label and are humbled by their journey, villains lack humility and view themselves as hero on a noble mission. Chapman believed he was on a mission. Heroes discover their missing inner quality and undergo a personal transformation. And villains don't. They're stuck at a low, immature stage. And Chapman was certainly stuck at a low, immature stage. Whereas the hero's deficiencies are corrected by humbling experience, the villain's mental and emotional deficiencies remain entrenched and become magnified over time. Yeah, sure, as time progressed, Chapman became sicker. Whereas heroes emerge victorious and enjoy long-term success with their goals, villains at best only achieve a short-term success and are ultimately defeated. Mark David Chapman, as I said, remains in jail. I'll leave it at that. Whereas heroes become the master of both worlds, remember the safe world and the scary world, villains never really master either one. Okay, a few more qualities of the villain. Often this dangerous new world is a world of abuse. Now we've seen what Chapman said about his father. The villain suffers psychological harm. Yeah, that certainly fits Chapman to a T. The mental illness distorts the villain's views of themselves and the world, often producing an extreme self-narcissism. Now, I don't think, hard to say, Chapman was narcissistic. I think of him as a man with a mission, and perhaps believing in somewhat of a religious sense that he had been chosen. The villain remains unaware of their skewed perception of reality, is never able to acknowledge their damaged state of mind. Well, perhaps Chapman knew he was ill, but he didn't have the ability to overcome it. The villain views themselves as a hero on a heroic mission. Sure, that fits Chapman, for Lennon was his imaginary villain. In the service of their mission, the villain performs one or more acts of violence that are irredeemable, and they propel that person to the status of villain. Sure, I mean, that could be a cut line under a photograph of Mark David Chapman, an act of violence that is irredeemable. The villain uses violence to accomplish many of their personal and social goals. Again, painfully accurate. In the end, the villain is defeated, but their evil deeds leave residual scars for society to cope with for many generations. Okay, yes, residual scars on a generation of music lovers and beyond. So was John Lennon's murder inevitable? Well, it was inevitable as much as anything is inevitable. Joseph Campbell helps us, in part, to understand the mind of Mark David Chapman and the seemingly inevitable trajectory of his crime, a crime that haunts us still. If heroes can have 1,000 faces, then so can villains, and Mark David Chapman is just one face among many. This is Dr. Ian Clarke, and you have been listening to Serious Rock Talk Crime. Until we meet again, visit our website and check out the long list of podcasts about one of your favorite subjects, rock and roll music. Thanks for listening.